and serving for 27 years, and he still continues to be a warrior till date, now actively involved in COVID-19 surveillance. Dr. Amitabh Banerjee graduated from Government Medical College, Jabalpur, and his doctorate in medicine from Armed Forces Medical College, Pune. He also holds a postdoctorate degree in clinical epidemiology from King George Medical College, Lucknow. Presently, he is the professor and head of the Department of Medicine at D.Y. Patil Medical College, Hospital and Research Center, Pune. He is also a clinical epidemiologist and editor-in-chief, Medical Journal of Dr. D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth, Pune, India. He has a number of achievements. To name a few, he has been awarded the Chief of Army Staff Gold Medal for best paper, that is Impact of Information Technology on the Armed Forces, in the year 1996 while he was serving in the Army. He was awarded from the Armed Forces for the best paper for tribal malaria in the year 2003. Best Published Paper Award, Outbreak Investigation of Viral Hepatitis E in the year 2005. One of his published papers on population and samples is being used as reading material in one of the research method courses being conducted by Stanford University. He has been awarded Publon's Peer Review Award in 2017 and also in 2018 as one of the top 1% reviewer of medical journals globally. He is also the reviewer for a number of international journals, including the British Medical Journal. His Google citations are 2013 citations. His H index is 19 and I-10 index 33 as on 15th of December 2020. He is a member of the task force of Pune District COVID control team. So he is the most appropriate person to deliberate on the journey of COVID-19 so far. Dr. Banerjee, sir, may I request you to please enlighten us on the journey of COVID-19 from Wuhan to today so far. Thank you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Colonel Chawla and Dr. Samir, for promoting me in the batting order, because I remember in the domestic crickets and Ranji Trophy, I used to bring me in the tail in the afternoon sessions. So in the international forum, I am happy that I am the opening bat. So it's a quite a difficult day for an opening bat to get the line and length, and the ball is new. Anyway, I'll try my best. My topic given to me is the journey so far in COVID-19, and clinical epidemiologists and biostatisticians are not very popular speakers, because they give too much of data and too much of graphs, and people go to sleep. So I will, for a change, I will be talking of the journey of COVID so far. I would be stressing more on the journey on the approaches to cope with COVID. I will be addressing more on the journey, how we have sometimes strayed from the evidence-based approach, how we have sometimes polarized, like instead of a healthy debate and considering different hypotheses, how we have somehow polarized and lost the scientific temper. So my talk would be basically mostly the conceptual journey and how the pandemic has laid bare the fault lines in the system. So as you are all are well aware, particularly of the figures, how many 70 million cases have occurred and 16 lakh deaths globally, and India also almost touching 1 crore cases and about 1.6 lakh deaths. So that figures we will see how also the journey so far. I would also be comparing the journey and the experiences of different countries. The journey and experiences of different countries and the lessons learned and the some hypotheses are, as it was classically, we know the descriptive epidemiology, how it is unfolding in different places, who are the people affected. The basic, if we go back to the basics, I would like to emphasize the take home messages and the path forward, the way forward for future research, instead of just copycatting the approaches in the West. Because as we see, once we see the data is different in different countries, so the approaches also have been different. I have my serious reservations that everybody is trying to fit one size fits all, and we are taking a cues from the northern hemisphere, wherever the whereas the epidemiology of COVID is entirely different in the southern hemisphere. So I would be stressing on that journey. So I'll just share this. First, I would send my greetings from my institution, D.Y. Patil Medical College. And as I said, I thank the organizers for giving us this opportunity. So anyway, this is something why I say in science, there is no conclusion. So actually, this came to me, this lesson came to me vividly just before the pandemic started in December in China in 2019. Sorry, I am going a century back. It is 2019. Just before the pandemic started in 2019, I was in a month before I was in Malaysia on a guest lecture. I was talking on the public health challenges, the newer challenges. And I concluded by saying, by quoting from this person, Bertrand Russell. Bertrand Russell, this was my last slide, that he said in the man's fight against, there are three conflicts. First is man is conflict against the nature, that is the environment, cyclone, environment, natural disasters, which includes the pandemics also. Then he says after the infections are controlled, the man, the non-communicable diseases, the violence, homicide and wars, man fights against his brothers. Then after he conquers the brothers, like America and Russia, they were at each other's neck. The world was bipolar, now only America. So there is no enemy. So man becomes the own enemy. And he indulges in alcohol, tobacco, unhealthy sex, unhealthy lifestyles. So I was saying, I concluded that we have arrived, that future public health challenges are going to be the non-communicable diseases. And within a month, we were back to the communicable disease again. The whole world was taken aback. So that's why I said it is in science, one cannot conclude. So though Bertrand Russell says these are the stages, we should now think that these are the cycles. From the lifestyle disease, again, we had gone back to the environment and infections. And the infections and environment are closely related, because there is ecological imbalance, there is animal-man contact, zoonosis. So this is again the environment. So from the lifestyle, again, we are back to the, and as we proceed, we will know that these two are also related. You see, if your lifestyle is poor, you are obese, you have got comorbidities, which will make you susceptible to COVID also infection. So everything is interrelated. These are the chess pieces which are working together, which should not be considered in isolation. So this COVID pandemic has taught us this. There is no, earlier we used to teach that non-communicable disease, only obesity and other things. Now with the COVID experience, we know that these things are important for communicable disease also, survival from communicable disease. So this is an important lesson. And as we compare the country data, we will see this in stark. The data will drive home this message very vividly. So as I said, these are not stages, but cycles. Assault by humans on environment, forest cover and habitat of animals are reduced. So therefore, presently, more than 70% of emerging diseases are of animal origin. So back to stage one. So environment and infections, we are still battling. So this is the start of the journey from Wuhan Seafood Market, as this is ground zero and wet market hide. So even today, we don't know who is the patient zero. So these are just contemplations, but most likely, it has started from this interface between man and animal. And what was the, as I said, this journey, I would be stressing more on the philosophical journey and the conceptual journey. How things have changed, approaches have changed. Outbreak originated in Wuhan in December 2019. China put Hubei district under lockdown in January 2020. China locked down only one district. Wuhan was in the Hubei district. It locked down only one district, and there was whole condemnation of China by the Western media. And even the WHO rep said that this lockdown of 56 million people is unprecedented in the history of public health, and it is not a recommendation WHO has made. Legal experts in the West said that this would be unconstitutional in a democracy and is authoritarian and unscientific. As long as China was doing it, everybody was criticizing it. Who would have thought? Evolution of the pandemic and the global response. It subsequently spread to other countries, and in subsequent months, the WHO, in March, WHO declared it a COVID-19 a pandemic. The very countries which has criticized China on its harsh measures surpassed it in implementing more crude and extreme forms of lockdown. China locked down one district, some countries, Italy was the one who locked down the whole country. And subsequently, we know we also went for a whole lockdown. So we exceeded China in such crude measures. And then the whole market chain, we overdid China, and experts advocated this as the norm to flatten the curve. So different jargons came up during the journey of flatten the curve, break the transmission, and so many things. Misleading cues, why these things happened. Lethality of the virus was overestimated in the early stages, leading to panic and knee-jerk reactions. The Lancet in early March suggested the case fatality rate to be 20%. So naturally, with this 20%, with the experience of Zika and SARS and other things, there was definitely we have to take the precautions, and how this case fatality rate was worked out, because of serious cases were getting in hospital, the denominator were of serious cases, so naturally the case fatality rate was there. Subsequent studies were refined studies like sero surveys and other things. The infection fatality rate, at least from many studies, as per the global infection fatality rate, as on the CDC site and WHO site, is now presently at 0.3 or 0.27 or 0.3. Indian infection fatality rate, tomorrow we'll be presenting the studies we carried out. It is coming to 0.17, the infection fatality rate, because most of the cases in the young people, we have got a young population, are asymptomatic or mild cases. So that enlarges the denominator. And the infection fatality rate depends on the age, depends on the vulnerability of the population. So by and large, overall, the global infection mortality rate is now 0.3. In our country, it may be 0.17. Different studies, estimates. Thailand, the first country outside China where the virus spread, was left off lightly, because probably Asian countries, as we will subsequently see, Asian countries are having the less impact. Maybe many factors we will discuss. However, the virus hit the ground running in Italy, overwhelming the coping capacity of hospitals. Actually, there was a lot of panic when Italy consists of large number of frail and very old people, above 80 years, 50% of the deaths were in above 80 years. Another thing, they mismanaged. They admitted everyone in hospitals and nursing homes, the nosocomial infection spread. There was a shortage of medical staff. And there was a nosocomial spread and spread in nursing homes. This was the way, because they were unprepared. Sweden also faced this, Europe also, and New York also faced this. The mismanagement because of crowding, infections in nursing homes. And because of the very aged population there. So naturally, at the end stage, any viral disease can cause high mortality in this vulnerable group. And unfortunately, these figures were taken to make the mathematical models. And these models were extrapolated to all over the world, different countries. And which naturally, because of this wrong inputs from mathematical models, these wrong inputs, whole world panicked. And depending, naturally, India also, the predictions even today, about a couple of months back, the prediction was that by the end of the year, there will be 2 lakh cases every day. Now we are getting just 20, 30,000 cases. All these mathematical models are because they are not taking the proper inputs of the field data. We will see subsequently. In the ensuing panic and chaos, Italy, as I said, was the first country to impose a country-wise lockdown. And then, of course, there was the role of media also. Focused on absolute numbers and medical emergency room, dramatizing the situation out of context. Of course, death is a tragedy, and nobody is denying that this pandemic is not serious. But this has been taken out of context compared to other global disease burdens. We have got many diseases which may be perhaps more lethal than this. So this somehow this took a center stage, as we will see. Social media was many countries were flooded with gory images and videos of people collapsing in the streets of Wuhan. I am very sure all of you must have seen such videos. And of course, sitting in lockdown, seeing these videos can cause a mass hysteria and mass panic. The seeds of global panic were sown by such information spiced with subtle doses of misinformation and China's reputation for opacity. So the pandemic of panic and hysteria fanned opinion, demanding more stringent measures. So such stringent measures, suspension of human rights, suspension of other things were accepted because of this belief that this is something very serious and very fatal. Then the scientific institutions also failed. Scientific institutions of repute erred miserably, as I said. Predictions based on mathematical models instead of proper epidemiological surveillance and papers without peer review projected doomsday and guided public policies. The most notorious is the model by Neil Ferguson. So these projected, because of the inputs of high fatality, even reported in a reputed journal like Lancet, 20%, definitely very high. If somebody gives us the figure, I'll also say close down everything. But it has to be refined as the more evidence comes. There is something called the precautionary principle. Yes, you err on the side of safety, but at the same time, keep on collecting the data and refining your models. Popular simulation models created shock and awe. You see, all these generations, even the social distancing and even mask as on today, if you do really serious review literature, they are based on computer simulations. And computer simulations are neat and clean. When you go to the ground, it cannot be as neat and clean, particularly in highly dense countries of Asia and Africa. Among this academic and scientific anarchy, government policies took shape in many countries. Flip-flops by WHO and CDC. Even today, they are flip-flopping, so it started from the beginning. This reflects the uncertainties and lack of an evidence-based approach. Initially, conflicting messages about use of masks. So naturally, the people get confused. Sometimes you say you use masks, sometimes you say masks should be used only by medical workers. Even the great Anthony Fauci also has a video saying the mask should not be used. Now he has got that entirely different video. So you see, within 6 months or within 3 months, if you are changing your statements. Then came the WHO U-turn that transmission is rare in asymptomatic cases. CDC also backtracked, there is no point in contact tracing. Then sometimes they are pushing for contact tracing and sometimes there are some statements. Such mixed messages undermine the public trust and even the credibility of science. And in this, everything gets hijacked. Initially, we imitated the communist approach, authoritarian approaches from communist China, all world lockdown. Subsequently, the agenda has been hijacked by market forces. We are getting the worst of communism and the worst of capitalism. So this is a political and conflict of interest angle also. So we are, as a scientist, we have to see through this conflict of interest and go on the hard evidence. Initially, worst of communism. Now, subsequently, we are facing the worst of capitalism in this promotion of testing kits or promotion of different. You see, even in the best journals, the Lancet and New England, they have been retracting paper on hydroxychloroquine and sometimes remdesivir, and now they are saying remdesivir doesn't work. So where is the... There's a flip-flop. There's a flip-flop by the WHO, CDC. There's a flip-flop by the scientific community also. So here we have to, yes, I don't say that this it doesn't happen in science, but we have to admit it that there are a lot of uncertainties. There were gradually the uncertainties are clearing. Still, there are some uncertainties. There cannot be any certainty in the scientific approach because science is not a dogma. We have to keep revising our beliefs and in the view of more evidence. So precautionary principle versus evidence-based policy. Even experts lack courage of conviction. When courage is lacking, healthy debate is discouraged. Science should not be afraid of a healthy debate. Science should not be, according to the precautionary principle, it is perfectly justified to err on the side of safety and advocate. As I said, when we don't know that it may be fatal, it may transmit better. Yes, better to err on side of safety, mask. Social distancing, test, trace, isolate, and lockdown. As we will see, some of these measures, we have to put a question mark how effective they are. However, these measures should be reviewed periodically in light of emerging evidence. There were some countries, minority like Sweden, Belarus, and Asia and Japan, they did not have lockdown. And their testing rates of course, were very low, particularly Japan and Thailand and Sri Lanka. They have got the lowest testing rates and the lowest mortality and lowest case. So that puts, at least some question is put whether these are really effective. And you see UK and USA have got the highest testing rate. They have got the highest cases. UK is a small country of 6 crores. Still, they are not able to test, trace, isolate, and still, in spite of all these measures, the cases are rising. So one should question at some time, ki how are they just waste of resources, or they are really helping? I mean, these are questions. I'm not saying they are right or wrong. So we have to review the evidence. Sweden is having the mortality less compared to other European countries. Japan is having the lowest, even Belarus having the lowest, in fact, lower than Sweden. They did not have a lockdown. Japan is having the, did not have a lockdown. So it has the lowest rates, even in spite of the very high age. As we will see, they have got a low obesity. So, and then there are 23 papers saying ki lockdown really doesn't work. So we have to see the evidence and again review our policy. Initially, it was justified. We did not know. Groups vulnerable, we know the elderly and hypertension, diabetes are very well known, obesity, comorbidity. Obesity, we will see, plays a very major role. Children, young adults, healthy, these are the people who are more likely to get over mildly. Children, it's almost touching zero mortality. So anyway, as I said, we have to have an approach like a game of chess. You don't go after, this is Viswanath Anand. This is the former world champion. So you see, in chess, you don't go only after the one. So what has happened is the journey of COVID has been only the Corona has become the queen in the chessboard. A beginning player only plays with the queen and may lose the match because other pieces are equally important. So what is the problem? Queen is Corona, but in our country, there we have got tuberculosis, we have got typhoid, we have got child malnutrition. So to win the game of good health, you should take care of the other pieces also. Just left with the queen, it will make you lose the game. You may save the queen, but lose the other game. As I said, Corona is queen. But we have to see, our chessboard is very crowded. We can't afford just to think of the queen. And epidemiology and chess are same. Sometimes the queen can be trapped by small pieces. I think this is what is happening in these small countries, in the Asian countries. We have got the number of small pieces which are trapping the queen, as we will see. This is the tale of three continents, which can give us a... This is the I have taken, not to clutter the screen, I have just taken some countries from different continents just to show the different way the journey or the pattern, the basics of epidemiology is just descriptive or ecological studies. So these are some ecological data. And I would anyone who is interested can make it their own tables and just see. These are the Western countries. If you see the Western countries, the death rate are very high, except for Belarus. Without lockdown, it is very low. And another thing which is to be noted are they are testing the maximum, more than 6 to almost 7 lakh per million. USA is testing, and still the deaths is 950. I have taken the death only because the death is more accurate. Number of cases depends on the intensity of testing. So that is a final pathway. So if you see Spain and even UK, I am not, but UK is also having higher rates of death. Sweden is not tested as much as USA, half the testing rate, but the case mortality is very less compared to USA. So this is just to see some ecological input, whether how much lockdown. Of course, Sweden is criticized and Sweden is compared with other Nordic countries. Yesterday, last week also, I had a debate with someone from UK. He says, you see, Sweden, you compare with Nordic. I said, why you are comparing with Nordic countries? Why you are not comparing with UK? Sweden is having much less deaths in UK. Because Nordic countries, if you see, I checked up the Nordic countries like Norway and other things, the ecology is different. Terrain is different. The geography is different. They are very dispersed people. They are staying in mountains and other things. They don't have, whereas Sweden, Stockholm and all other metropolis hubs. So London and similarly Mumbai in India and Pune, we had very high because they are the hubs. So you can't compare a hilly region with a metropolis region. So yes, then he agreed to that. So we should see in epidemiology, we should see the terrain, the geography, everything. Now what is happening nowadays, we are losing this basic thinking or critical thinking skill. And now you see the Asian and the African countries. You see the testing rates in Japan or Sri Lanka is just 48,000 and the death rate is just, this is yesterday, is just 7 per million. Similarly, India and similarly, African countries also, they have got very less death than except for South Africa. Another thing I was trying to correlate is the median age. So wherever the median age is high, so as I said, the age, elderly population, that is one. More important than the median age is the overweight. This is the overweight from the WHO side. This is the overweight different countries. You see, USA, 68% of the people are BMI over 25. 62% Spain, almost 60% of the northern hemisphere overweight. Whereas the Asian countries, overweight is just 1/3. And Japan is a very interesting. Japan is an older age profile even than the north, western countries. Japan is the highest life expectancy and still they have got the lowest mortality, 22. Almost 50 times less than the Western countries. So Japan, what does Japan teaches us? That this is the lifestyle and obesity. Japan ka obesity above BMI above 25 is just 27%. So 1/3 of the obesity of the Western countries. So obesity will compromise the lung function. Obesity is a surrogate marker of comorbidities. And now there are studies, earlier there were studies on influenza and obesity, the higher mortality in influenza. Now there are studies with that, this obesity, higher mortality in the COVID also, because it compromises, per se obesity can compromise the lung function. Similarly, if you see the African countries, there are some countries where the obesity is high. Egypt has got a higher obesity, 63%, and South Africa got a higher obesity compared to other African countries. And you see, with the obesity, the cases among South African, these are high. And otherwise, their age is less. So age and obesity is the major factor. So these are the small, and another study which is coming up, large number of studies now are pointing to other causality with other coronaviruses. That in this African and Asian countries, people are living in slums, highly dense, there is a lot of transmission of other coronaviruses. So they develop, the immune systems are primed to respond to this novel coronavirus because exposure to earlier coronaviruses. So this this hypothesis is also coming into more prominence. So demographic, obesity, these are the smaller chess pieces, and these are a combination. Like in chess, the smaller pieces in combination, they trap the queen. So these may have been trapping the queen in the Africa and Asian countries. So because of this, we require more research in this. You see, of course, obesity is well known per se, and demography, of course, that is something which is there. And cross immunity with Aranok, if this comes up in a big way, we may have to rethink how much social distancing to do, how much hand washing to do. Because this may be, if there is something called the hygiene hypothesis. Suppose something may be because of this hygiene, probably the Western people are more vulnerable. Their immune system is less primed. And if we have the advantage of a better immune system, are we going the wrong direction? This is a question. I will not give any opinion. Anybody who gives opinion in COVID times is, you know, not very popular. So, or sometimes he or she is proved wrong. So I am just pointing at some of the research questions which can come. The journey, these are the research, as a scientist, we should think on these, identify for future research. Now I am also reminded of the journey. Journey becomes a end mein kya hota hai, wo daur ho jata hai, naya daur. I mean, I don't know, I am from a very old generation. Most of you have not, may not have seen this movie, Naya Daur. It is an old movie, but the door is still naya. This is Dilip Kumar. This is Vaijayanti Mala. This is Ajit. So this was a movie in which there is a village. Actually, what happens is when, you know, on our times, we were more towards socialism, village life, manpower and other things. There was a skeptical attitude towards technology or industrialization, motorization. So in this small village, the people were having a happy life, and there was also a romantic angle and all that. In this happy, industrialist comes who wants to motorize, and he brings a motorized bus to take the people. And these people are Tonga Wala. So they thought that their business will be affected. So there is a huge, there is a conflict between the modernity and the conventional here. So I was thinking a similar thing is happening, not to say, I mean, ultimately the Tangawala reaches the finishing point, it wins the race against the motor by some shortcut or some path or something. And in the movie, the technology loses. So anyway, that does not mean that we are not going in Tanga today. You see, whenever there is a new thing, this vaccine is the latest thing. The journey we have reached the end of vaccine. Vaccine is technology, and there are a lot of people who have been skeptical about vaccine, like the Tanga Wallas were skeptical of the motor. And now the question is whether the Tanga will reach or the bus will reach. So here, whether the herd immunity will reach first, bring down the cases, or whether the vaccine will bring down the cases. So it is the Naya Dor with Moderna vaccine. So this is the same. I was just thinking the similarity ki yaar aisa to pehle picture dekha tha humne aur us time bhi tange wale log ki jeet hui thi. Abhi herd immunity ka jeet hoga, but that does not mean ki abhi hum tange mein ja rahe hain. Abhi hum basi mein aate hain roz. To ho sakta hai ki abhi skepticism kyun hai ki ek saal mein kabhi vaccine nahi bana. To itna jaldi bana nahi hai, to isliye thoda dar hai. हो सकता है पहले पहले जब गाड़ियां बनी थी, मोटर बने थे, तो 18 या 10 किलोमीटर प्रति घंटे चलता था, उसमें भी एक्सीडेंट हो जाता था. तो वैक्सीन जब नया नया बनेगा, थोड़े बहुत साइड इफेक्ट्स होते हैं, तो इससे थोड़ा डर तो लगता है. पहले लोगों को गाड़ी में डर लगता था, तो ऐसे वैक्सीन में डर लग रहा है. बट इन द लॉन्ग रन परहैप्स वी विल वेट फॉर द थिंग्स टू रिफाइन एंड द वैक्सीन मे विन इन द लॉन्ग रन. अभी एक साल में बन रहा है, हो सकता है बाद में 6 महीने में बनेंगे. दैट इज द टेक्नोलॉजी. So this is just again I am putting a comparison. So herd immunity can be compared to the Tonga in Naya Dor. Vaccines can be compared to the motorized variant. You go and see Naya Dor again. You will get some lessons. Naya Dor, good songs are also good. Dances are also good. Naya Dor with Moderna and other vaccines. So yeah, these are the global. What I am saying is, जो भी प्रॉब्लम है वेस्टर्न कंट्रीज में ज्यादा है, ये ग्लोबल रेट्स आर डेफिनेटली राइजिंग एंड समहाउ ऑल कंट्री कैन बिकम अ गुड पेट्री डिश ऑफ कोविड. एक्चुअली ऑल कंट्री इज गोइंग एंटायरली डिफरेंट. ऑल कंट्री में अभी भी टोंगा तेज चल रहा है, बिकॉज वी विल शो दिस इज द ग्राफ ऑफ द ग्लोबल ग्राफ एंड दिस ग्राफ इज ड्रिवन बाय द नॉर्दर्न हेमिस्फीयर. अनदर एस्पेक्ट इन द नॉर्दर्न हेमिस्फीयर इज दैट उनके यहाँ जो विंटर में ये सीजनल निमोनिया डेथ्स होते हैं, अर्लियर इट वॉज द इन्फ्लुएंजा डेथ, H1N1 डेथ, इस बार कोविड इज द क्वीन. COVID is killing more. So it is a seasonal phenomenon rather than the second wave. This is the deaths. Global deaths is again, they say it is again rising. These are the global. And now we see the Indian data, very fascinating. This is the Indian data. Ye hamara tanga aa raha hai. Ye niche ki taraf ja raha hai. Abhi kal isme 28,000 cases the, parso 20,000 the, 30,000 cases ho rahe hai. These are the new cases. We are going down. We are reaching the finishing point. ये डेथ्स का भी ऐसे ही हो रहा है. कल डेथ्स 353 थे. इससे ज्यादा तो हमारा ट्रैफिक एक्सीडेंट से डेथ हो जाते हैं. ट्रैफिक एक्सीडेंट से यंग लोगों के डेथ हो जाते हैं. ये तो ओल्ड लोगों के डेथ हो रहे हैं. ओल्ड पीपल आर डाइंग. ऑफ कोर्स एज आई सेड, डेथ इज अ ट्रेजेडी, बट इन पब्लिक हेल्थ देयर इज समथिंग कॉल्ड वेइंग द अदर हेल्थ प्रॉब्लम्स. देयर इज समथिंग कॉल्ड डेली डिसेबिलिटी एडजस्टेड लाइफ इयर्स. इफ यू सी कोविड का डेली क्यों नहीं बताते हो आप? अभी फर्स्ट वैक्सीन वॉज टेकन बाई अ 90-year-old लेडी इन UK. अभी 90 ईयर में ठीक है, 90 ईयर में हम तो 190 ईयर्स भी जिए हमको कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है. पर हमारे यहाँ अंडर 5 2000 बच्चे रोज मरते हैं. 2000 अंडर 5 चिल्ड्रेन डाई इन इंडिया. 1400 पीपल डाई इन ट्यूबरक्लोसिस ऑफ इंडिया. मोर्टेलिटी रेट इवन विथ ट्रीटेड ट्यूबरक्लोसिस इज 5%. BCG वैक्सीन इज देयर टिल 5% मोर्टेलिटी. 2000 चिल्ड्रेन इन इंडिया डाई डेली. दीज आर दी अदर चेस पीसेस वी आर नेग्लेक्टिंग. कोविड अपने आप नीचे जा रहा है, आप देखिएगा. दीज आर, आई एम जस्ट टेलिंग द डेटा, आई एम नॉट सेइंग एनी ओपिनियन. सो आर वी हेडिंग फॉर एन एक्साइटिंग फिनिश इन इंडिया? हर्ड इम्यूनिटी और वैक्सीन विच विल कम फर्स्ट, टाइम एंड ओनली कैन टेल. वॉट अबाउट अदर एंडेमिक डिजीजेस? हु इज काउंटिंग द अदर डिजीजेस? कौन ट्रैफिक एक्सीडेंट का रोज फिगर दे रहा है? कौन चाइल्ड डेथ का रोज फिगर दे रहा है? So the typhoid का कौन फिगर दे रहा है? Typhoid का वैक्सीन है, why we don't go for it? So these are the questions I have. Then paradigm shift in epidemiology from shoe leather to mouse click epidemiology. Shoe leather में observation and measurement at grassroots level. अभी कहते हैं mask से सब कुछ ठीक हो जाएगा, mask is a vaccine. I see people wearing mask, I observe at the ground level. I saw my wife with a mask, रास्ते में mask में मेरे साथ जा रही थी. When she went to the shop, she entered, she pulled down the mask. The shopkeeper also pulled down the mask. What were speaking indoors without mask? I pulled out my wife. I said, "Yaar, mask to bahar nikal lo, andar pehenna chahiye." So every if you go to the slum, nobody is wearing mask. It's not possible to wear mask. Everybody in one room, there are 10 people. So these are the we are losing on the soul leather epidemiology. Armchair it gave way to armchair epidemiology. Bed ke aap paper par ke aap prediction bana rahe. Now we are in the age of mouse click epidemiology. Mathematical model with incomplete data inputs. We need to try. I am not saying ki these are not to be used or armchair epidemiology not to be used because hypothesis aata hai. Armchair saying then, but you should combine all three rather than depending only on one aspect. आजकल कोई फील्ड में नहीं जाता है कोविड के डर से और नहीं जाता है हमने सीरो सर्वे किया कोई जाने के लिए तैयार नहीं था स्लम में और यंग रेजिडेंट्स वेंट सो वी नीड टू ट्रायंगुलेट ऑल अवर मेथड्स रादर देन वर्किंग इन आइसोलेशन नाउ अनदर प्रॉब्लम इज दैट अदर फिनोमेना इज देयर इज अ ग्रेट बैरिंगटन डिक्लेरेशन यू मे हैव हर्ड व्हिच वाज काउंटर्ड बाय द जॉन स्नो स्टेटमेंट इन लैंसेट इफ यू अवेयर अ ग्रुप ऑफ epidemiologists and reputed medical experts, they said ki this lockdown and all is causing more harm and they suggested a focused prevention, focused protection. Focused protection means they are saying ki vulnerable group ko isolate karo, let the young and healthy go and resume their duties, resume their school colleges. Immediately there was a counterpoint as the John Snow statement. John Snow statement named after John Snow who did the full leather epidemiology. So if you see, उन्होंने कहा कि देयर इज नो एविडेंस दैट द हर्ड इम्यूनिटी विल वर्क विदाउट रियलाइजिंग कि देयर इज नो एविडेंस दैट लॉकडाउन वर्क्स और द मास्क वर्क्स और द सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग वर्क्स देयर हैव बीन पेपर्स व्हिच आर नॉट रियली आई मीन द एविडेंस इज वीक एज आई सेड इट इज द प्रिकॉशनरी प्रिंसिपल व्हिच सेज कि यस अंटिल अनलेस वी नो दैट इज बेटर टू टेक सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग इट इज बेटर टू वेयर मास्क एंड बेटर टू थर्ड क्या हैंड वॉशिंग बेटर टू डू हैंड वॉशिंग So yes, I am not saying denying that this should not be done, but anyway, there is no. But at least there is a evidence that other diseases are taking its toll. Are these two parallel lines destined to meet infinity? What we have to see now, even when the vaccine has come, the resources are not there, the logistics are not available to vaccinate the whole community. So they will be giving vaccine to the elderly and the vulnerable. So ye Barrington wale bhi to hi keh rahe hain na. वो भी कह रहे थे यार उस टाइम वैक्सीन नहीं था अक्टूबर में इन्होंने बैरिंगटन डिक्लेरेशन बनाया था इन्होंने कहा था कि भाई अभी जो मेथड्स अवेलेबल है हैंड वॉशिंग है सोशल आइसोलेशन है एंड डिस्टेंसिंग है एंड मूवमेंट रिस्ट्रिक्शन है लेट इट बी टू द वल्नरेबल ग्रुप सो दे आर प्रोटेक्टिंग द वल्नरेबल ग्रुप अभी वैक्सीन आ गया तो वो भी तो बोल रहे ना वैक्सीन पहले वल्नरेबल ग्रुप को दो ना अब वो थोड़ी चार साल में अगर रोल आउट होगा तो चार साल स्कूल कॉलेज वर्क प्लेस तो बंद नहीं रख सकते हो सो दीज आर बोथ आर फिलोसफिकली सेम स्टिल देयर इज अ पोलराइजेशन So we have to restore the scientific temper of debate, considering alternative views and hypotheses. This is the way forward. Let us regain the scientific temper. So I have not, don't say that I have said this. I have said that I have tried to, present the different points of view, and you make your own here and regain the scientific temper. The science should not be like dogma, blind belief, whatever. Always consider the other. So I have finished here. These are some of the references. And one of the references which we have got opportunity to a sero survey and Colonel Chawla and Dr. Samir were very kind to allow us to present the data. They have given us a lot of time and we are really thankful to them. So tomorrow again our team will be presenting this sero survey and the lessons learned. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Manaji sir. A very lucid, a very smooth journey you took us through. It was as if we were driving on an expressway without any speed breakers. Even we did not face the toll plaza. So, and that's the reason probably why we have no question in the chat box. But still, we can. There has been only appreciation of your examples given. One of the participants, Swati Deshpande, says, "Sir, Naya Daur is really an apt example." So and as usual, your humorous talk and making a very difficult topic very light and interesting. You are well known for that, sir. So thank you very much, and also we thank you for sticking to your time schedule. And of course, if still there are questions from Dr. Banerjee, you can type it in the chat box. We can anytime during the conference in between.